Assalamu alaikum. My name is Dr. Awais Khalid. I am the senior registrar in Medical Unit 5, DHQ Hospital, Faisalabad. Today we will going to discuss about the rheumatic heart disease. It is a bit lengthy topic. To understand rheumatic heart disease, we have to understand first of all acute rheumatic fever. In the coming lecture, you will going to discuss about the individual valve that is be affected in the rheumatic heart disease. So rheumatic heart disease develop in at least half of the patient affected from acute rheumatic fever with carditis. Actually, repeated infection of acute rheumatic fever result in the chronic rheumatic heart diseases. All the patient affected, most of them are female, about 2/3 are female, and most common valve that is affected is mitral valve. It is about 90% that is mitral valve is involved. Other valves in descending orders are aortic valve, tricuspid valve, and the least one is the pulmonary valve. Mitral stenosis is the most common cause of the rheumatic heart disease. Well, it is about 25% alone in rheumatic heart disease, and as mixed mitral valve disease, it is about 40% of the rheumatic heart disease cases. As a result of repeated attacks of rheumatic fever, there is progressive fibrosis, as these autoantibodies that are formed as a result of re-exposure to the streptococcal infection. These antibodies are deposited over the inner lining of the valve, like valve borders, commissures. And so there is a case, 15-year-old girl presented in medical outdoor with complaint of fever for the last 3 weeks, along with joint pains involving knees and elbows. She gave a history of sore throat 3 weeks ago. On examination, temperature was 102 degree Fahrenheit. A rash was noted over the trunk. CBC shows raised TLC count that is 15,000 per microliter, and ESR was 60 mm per hour. ECG shows first degree heart block. Now we have a patient that is young female with past history of sore throat. She has a fever and joint pains and a rash over the trunk. There is raised TLC and inflammatory markers like ESR is raised. Also in ECG, there is first degree heart block. These are all findings suggestive of acute rheumatic fever. What are the possible differential diagnoses of this disease? Now coming back to the scenario with young female and fever and arthritis, one would have the possibility she might have disease like SLE, rheumatoid arthritis, juvenile rheumatoid arthritis, that is Still disease, and reactive arthritis. In all these conditions, joints are involved and there's arthritis. But but the rash that is present in SLE is usually on the face and it is a butterfly rash. It is not present over the abdomen. The rash in juvenile rheumatoid arthritis is salmon color rash. It is present over the upper part of the body, and it is not. It is also associated with organomegaly like hepatomegaly, splenomegaly, and lymphadenopathy. That are not present in our case. Rheumatoid arthritis usually involves small joints, and it is symmetrical in nature. Symmetrical joints are involved. In this case, we don't have the clear pattern of the joint involvement, and the rash is usually not present in rheumatoid arthritis. Reactive arthritis, there might be history of some genital presentation. Acute rheumatic fever. It is a multi-system disease that involves heart, brain, skin, and joints. Most common cause of acquired diseases of heart in child age and adolescence, and mean age of this disease is 5 to 15 years. Or in now, what is the pathology and pathogenesis that lead to acute rheumatic fever? Actually, as a result of antibodies formation that was triggered by an immune mediated delayed response to the infection with group A beta hemolyticus streptococci. These antibodies that cross react with cardiac myosin and sacralamal membrane of the musculoskeletal system. These cardiac myosin sacralamal membrane may also behave in a similar way to the glycoprotein that is present in the streptococci. So the antibodies that are formed against these streptococci will going to attach to these myosin and sacralamal membrane, and they will going to cause the damage. These antibodies will cause inflammation to the heart. All layers of heart can be involved. There will be carditis, you can say pancarditis, or it may involve any one of the heart membrane. It can involve endocardium, myocardium, and even pericardium. One could have the presentation of any one of these walls that are involved. Joint and skin manifestation and CNS manifestation are also present. Ashoff nodules are the pathognomonic features that occur when the myocardial membrane is involved. It occurs in acute inflammatory phase, and it is the pathognomonic feature. what are the clinical features as we discussed in our case? It's a multi-system disorder. There could be history of anorexia, fever, lethargy, joint pains, and past history of streptococcal pharyngitis. These complaints, anorexia, fever, lethargy, and joint pain, are because of the inflammatory process that is going on because of the streptococcal pharyngitis. In some cases, there may be no history of pharyngitis, as patient may unable to recall or give the history of sore throat, but remember the arthritis may be the only presentation that people used to tell when they give history that they have the joint pains. Arthritis occurs in 75% of the patients, and arthritis in rheumatic fever is large joint arthritis. Small joints are spared, and it is not involving in a typical pattern. Not all the joints are involved at the same time. It is migratory, fleeting arthritis. One could have arthritis of one joint, and in the coming 2 or 3 days, that joint may. So, this is the Jones criteria for diagnosis of rheumatic fever. One have major criteria and minor criteria. Major criteria, major manifestation, carditis, polyarthritis, chorea, and skin manifestation like erythema marginatum and subcutaneous nodules. Minor criteria, we have fever, arthralgia, previous rheumatic fever, raised inflammatory markers like ESR, CRP, leukocytosis, first degree heart blocks, ESO titer. And the additional things that to be seen is the ESO titers or the streptococcal antibody titers, or the recent history of scarlet fever or sore throat or streptococcal infection. That could be we get from the ESO titer or antibody titer to the streptococcal. So, what is revised John criteria? It is based upon two or more major or one major, two or more minor manifestation, along with evidence of preceding streptococcal infection. So, serological evidence of recent infection with raised ESO is helpful. In some cases, we can say when we have pancarditis and pseudonym chorea, CNS manifestation, presumptive diagnosis of rheumatic fever can be made even without the evidence of streptococcal infection. But we have to exclude the other causes of carditis and CNS manifestation. So, cardiac manifestation, carditis. As we know, heart is made up of three membranes. The outer one is pericardium, the inner muscular layer myocardium, and inner lining that lines the inner lining of the chamber and the valve is endocardium. These three layers can be involved simultaneously or individually depending upon the mode of the disease. Patient might present with breathlessness, palpitation, or chest pain, tachycardia, cardiac enlargement, and new or change member might be the finding that we get on our investigation. Soft systolic murmur due to aortic mitral regurgitation is common. That is more common in myocarditis. When this myocardium is involved, there is dilatation of the heart and we have the mitral regurgitation. One could have the mid-diastolic murmur due to the valvulitis and nodule formation over the mitral valve. As I have told you that these antibodies that are deposited on the inner lining of the heart on the valves, mitral valve most commonly. Aortic regurgitation in rheumatic acute rheumatic fever is about 50% of the cases. The semilunar walls like pulmonary walls and the tricuspid in the atrial ventricle wall like tricuspid wall are rarely involved. So pericarditis present with central chest pain and it will be more on lying and patient feel comfort on sitting position and it there will be frictional pericardial rub on auscultation and one patient could have the precordial tenderness. Cardiac failure due to myocardial dysfunctioning or valve regurgitation is due to the myocardial dysfunctioning or myocarditis. Arthritis, most common presentation that patient recall is joint pains. And arthritis is usually present when inflammatory markers are raised, inflammatory changes are present. Patient have painful asymmetric migratory inflammatory knees, large joints are involved, knees, ankles, elbows and wrist. Hand joints and foot joints are usually spared. Joints are involved in quick successions. They are red, swollen and tender. Joint pain usually respond characteristically to the S pain. So in this picture we can see the left knee is swollen and you can see the erythema and shiny. This is the skin region, erythema marginatum. As the name indicate, erythema mean redness, marginatum that is present, redness present at the margins. It is present in less than 5% of the cases, usually over the trunks and proximal extremities. Started with the red macule that fades from the centers, and the margins are still reddish, bit raised. Skin nodules, their size usually small, up to 2 cm. They are firm and painless and present over the extensor surfaces of the bones or the tendons. They appear in the 3 weeks after the disease. They are help in making diagnosis, but not the characteristic. Both bilian are included, erythema marginatum and skin nodules in the skin lesion. This is the slide of erythema marginatum. As you can see, the central pale surface with slightly reddish margins and bit raised. The above, the biggest of all is the characteristic, and the third one over the bottom is the new eruptive erythema marginatum. This is another slide which shows the erythema marginatum over the trunk. These are the nodules, as you can see, on the extensor surfaces. How will you investigate the case of acute rheumatic fever? We can see the evidence of systemic illness as inflammatory markers like leukocytosis, raised ESR and C-reactive proteins. Evidence of preceding streptococcal infection like we can get from throat swab cultures. ASO titers, rising antibody titers or levels of ASO more than 200 units in adults and more than 300 units in children. Evidence of carditis can be seen on chest X-ray. We can have cardiomegaly, pulmonary congestion due to heart failure. And ECG, we could have first degree heart block and ST changes and T wave inversions, and reduction is QRS voltages that is seen in the pericarditis. Echocardiography shows the well functioning myocardial status and the pericardial membrane status. There could be cardiomegaly, wall dysfunctioning, wall abnormalities. These murmur can be picked on the echocardiography, even though unable to pick on the clinical examination. Management of the acute attack. Antibiotic single dose benzyl penicillin 1.2 million unit intramuscularly is enough for the acute attack. Or if patient want to take oral medication, phenoxymethyl penicillin 250 mg 6 hourly for 10 days should be enough. For penicillin allergic patient, we can give erythromycin, cephalosporin. Supportive care and bed rest as the patient has swollen tender joint. So patient should be advised bed rest. Cardiac failure due to the valve dysfunctioning, mitral aortic regurgitation can be treated if it is present by the medical treatment. We can give vasodilators, we can give diuretics, and if medical treatment is not responsive, then we can plan for the valve replacement. Pacemaker is needed. How will you going to treat the arthritis? The magic drug aspirin usually response occur within 24 hours, and it also help us in making the diagnosis. Meanwhile, the other workup has been sent and patient is put on the aspirin. Patient magically improve within the 24 hours and help us in supporting our provisional diagnosis of acute rheumatic failure fever. Starting dose is 60 mg per kg per day in 6 divided doses. In adults, 100 mg per kg per day. Maximum dose is 8 gram per day. Regarding aspirin, one should look for the side effects like nausea, tinnitus, metabolic acidosis, and tachypnea, vomiting, and deafness. That should be also monitored. The response of the treatment is seen with the successive fall in the ESR and C-reactive. Corticosteroids are usually not required in mild cases. Patient respond to the aspirin, but in severe arthritis and carditis, they can be given and no long-term benefit of giving for the long time has been documented. And dose will be prednisolone 1 to 2 milligram per kg per day in divided doses. And again, inflammatory marker should be observed as the patient on steroid and can be reduced or tapered down. Secondary prevention: long-term prophylaxis with penicillin, benzyl penicillin 1.2 million unit intramuscularly monthly should be given, or oral phenoxymethyl penicillin 250 mg 12 hourly should be given for secondary prevention to prevent the secondary attacks of the acute rheumatic fever. For the patient allergic to the penicillin, sulfadiazine and erythromycin can be given. Long-term antibiotic prevents. Now, these are American Heart Association recommendation for duration of secondary prophylaxis. On the left side, there is a category of the patient, and on the right side, duration for the prophylaxis. If rheumatic fever is without carditis, duration for prophylaxis 5 years after the last attack or 21 years of the age, whichever is the longer. if rheumatic fever with carditis but no residual valve disease. For 10 years after the last attack or 21 years of age, whichever is longer. Rheumatic fever with persistent valvular disease evident clinically or on echocardiography. For 10 years after the last attack or 40 years of age, whichever is longer. Sometime lifelong prophylaxis is needed. So this was the all about acute rheumatic fever. Thank you for patient listening.